All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome to episode 61 of Going Live with Good Soil. Matt and myself are back in action. Last week, Yashu from Hit That Bid took my spot for the week and guest hosted with you, Matt. I listened later and thought you guys did a great job. I was on vacation in Hawaii and sick, unfortunately. Me and my three kids were all sick. My wife wasn't, but we all had some bronchitis thing. So a little rough, but, you know, it was better to be in Hawaii sick than homesick, I thought. How's it going, Matt? Okay.
Yeah, things are going pretty well. Markets continue to, you know, kind of sell off. So I don't know.
If you
missed like the last week and a half or so of kind of market sell off, and you'd think being in Hawaii would be a really good way to avoid that stress, but you were just sick instead. So
I was sick and I was stressed because I still was looking at my phone, the markets and Twitter feeds, and I was like, oh no, we're down even more. And yeah, an interesting question I want to, you know, we talk about macro markets first always and what's going on in the macro markets. Then we go into like Tesla, Elon stuff and Twitter or whatever. And then we go into like other stocks to cover in the Q&A. So that's the format of this weekly episode for anyone sort of new. And so starting off with macro markets, someone had asked me on Twitter, you know, a few days ago, is my estimate still like 60 or 70% that we have like a soft landing of the markets, you know, the stock market, you know, in the next few months? Because I remember like 2 weeks ago, I think I mentioned, I thought I was feeling confident, you know, the markets were rallying and It was before the Jackson Hole meeting and everything. And I did feel confident. I felt like 60, 70% chance that, you know, we were due for the markets to continue rallying and there would be a nice soft landing because inflation was going down. And I was going off of like believing what I thought, what I interpreted as Powell's comments, meaning he's going to follow the data. In the last Fed meeting, when he gave his speech, that was like the big point. Like they're not committed to what they're doing the next Fed meeting. They're going to follow the data. So people thought that was like, oh, he's open to not going up 75 basis points every time if the data shows that inflation is getting under control. That's what I interpreted it as. And it seemed to be going that direction with the CPI coming in low. And now the Cleveland Fed is revising their CPI print for August down to 0.1%. It was 0.2% just like a few weeks ago. Now it's 0.1%. So if the CPI print for August comes out in a week and it's like 0.1% or zero or even negative, you would think that the Fed should follow the data and be like, hey, look, inflation's really under control. We don't need to raise 75 basis points. We can raise 25 basis points, you know, and the market would take that very joyously with the macro market breadth would go, you know, up. And but it doesn't seem like Powell is looking at that data. It seems like he's looking at something else. What do you think, Matt? I mean, what's going on here?
Yeah, it did seem to be a bit of an about face because you're right. You know, 2 weeks ago it was we're going to be like we've raised very aggressively year to date and we're going to, you know, be data dependent moving forward. And the markets clearly loved that with the kind of rally we saw over the last, you know, month and a half, 2 months, excluding the last 2 weeks. But then on Friday, I was really surprised by kind of the tone of his comments. I mean, listening to his speech, he was, you know, basically saying like there's going to be hard times ahead for the economy because we're going to have to like sacrifice, you know, jobs and GDP growth kind of like at the altar of inflation. It's like if we just let inflation get out of hand, it'll be way worse than anything else, which I think is fair. But he said, so we're going to use like every tool in our chest, you know, aggressively. That wasn't exactly his quote. I don't have it written down here, but his tone and the words that he was using were just, I think, way more hawkish than people were expecting. And it seems so confusing that like, you're like, oh, we're going to be data dependent. And then, you know, markets rally is like, well, that was too much of a rally. I don't like that. So we got to like whack the markets down again. It's just,
I mean, what data would he need? Like what data would he need to be dependent on the data to not go up 75 basis points? Like, I don't understand what data could have changed his view from not going up 75 basis points in that case. Right. I mean, it feels like we got the best case of data going and he's still saying they're going to raise 75 basis points. It's strange. Anyway, it's just like,
I think so. I mean, he said something to the effect of like, you know, the July data that we got good, but there's no way that we're going to, you know, change course based on 1 month's print or something like that.
Yeah.
Right. Well, then you kind of risk, they completely mishandled, you know, and, you know, had just like did not, they kept rates too low for too long. Like that's widely agreed upon. Inflation wasn't transitory. They were just really late to the game. And my fear is now they're kind of going on the same course where they're like, well, they're going to keep correcting way longer than is necessary to really get inflation under wraps and cause some collateral damage on the economy and on job growth. So, I don't know. Well, it's kind of interesting the way they keep changing their tune, but it certainly was not a good sign, I think, for equities and for the prospects of continued rate hikes going forward. So, I don't know. Have you thought about a new percentage? You were at 70% a couple of weeks ago of a soft landing.
Yeah. Well, I'd say soft landing by the end of the year. I'm at 50-50 at this point. You know, I mean, it's only been a couple of weeks. It's not terrible. It's still sort of more optimistic than I think the market thinks.
Yeah.
But it's not as optimistic as I was. You know, it's come down considerably just because I don't know what this Fed is doing. Like, they don't care about a recession. Maybe they just care about being seen as the Fed that saved us from inflation. You know, like, no matter what happens in recession, at least they saved 10% inflation. They fixed it. Even though them changing interest rates, I don't even think is what's fixing it. I think it's just it was an inflationary shock from all these, like what Kathy Wood is saying. I think that seems to be more of the question. Like, them increasing interest rates by 75 basis points for, you know, the last couple of months hasn't changed the month over month CPI from being, you know, 2% to, or, you know, 1.5% to 0.1%. That alone didn't do it. You know, it's more clear that it was an inflationary shock wave that we had for like 1 year. And now things are kind of, it's like a rubber band and it's bouncing back, you know? And so I think maybe them being extra aggressive in raising rates couldn't help the Fed being perceived by the general public that they saved the world from great inflation or something, you know? So, you know, maybe that's a cynical view, but hopefully that's not why you're doing it.
I do agree with you though. Like, I think a lot of the things that are outside the Fed's control, such as commodity prices, and I think in particular, a lot of these like supply chain shocks stuff.
Yeah,
that we were talking a lot about like 3-4 months
commerce
ago.
China, yeah.
Those are like legitimate things of like, you look at the cost of a shipping container and how far that's, you know, come down in recent months. I mean, that was a huge contributor to inflation. And it's not like raising rates clears up the port of LA or gets, you know, ships out of Shanghai. So, I do think the Fed, you know, is maybe has a bit of a God complex here and is trying to, you know, thinks they have more control than really they do. And so they may be, you know, adjusting levers too aggressively when some of this stuff will just sort itself out naturally. You know,
the one thing they can, I feel like, clearly control is the housing market with a bit of a lag. Yeah. You know, the mortgage rates have gone up dramatically because of the Fed raising rates, and that's cooled off the housing market faster, which then cools off, like, you know, housing businesses, whether it's Home Depot and Lowe's for remodeling houses or whatever, everything housing related gets cooled off dramatically. You know, it's kind of a domino effect. So they're definitely putting that domino effect in place. And, you know, but it's just frustrating that the Fed is in control of our portfolio performance so much these days. It's very frustrating. Like, you can pick the best stock in the world, you know, but still be down dramatically because all the stocks are going down because of the Fed, or all the stocks are going up because of the Fed. It's not the type of investing that we like, you know, like in any kind of medium short term time frame. Long term, if you're a stock picker and you pick a good stock, you'll be great. You'll do great anyway. But over any like few month period, you know, or a year to date period, it's totally dependent on what the Fed's doing. It's frustrating.
Yeah. Macro does seem, I mean, very clearly to have kind of outweighed impact. I mean, everything's down, I don't know, like at best 20% and at worst, you know, like 80% or something, 90% some stocks. And it's just like fundamentals are kind of impacting to some small extent, I think, you know, to what extent that the downward movement has been. You know, but it is kind of just crazy how, you know, like even Tesla has just like outstanding fundamentals relative to the price right now. I think you do too. And seeing it get beat up like this, I'm like, well, this doesn't make any sense. But
no,
it's just so macro. Like, everybody's scared. Like, nobody wants to put money at risk right now. There's a lot more put buying. You know, there was all sorts of call buying the last, you know, 2-3 years, and it seems like this year all that kind of like YOLO into meme stocks has gone into like.
It's the year of put mine. Yeah. Yeah, people are buying a lot of index puts and stuff like that. Yeah, absolutely. So is Tesla, now it's the split happens, you know, we're down as we speak, $8, you know, almost 3%. I mean, before the split, that was $24, I guess, which would feel, it just psychologically would feel more painful. But, you know, 3% is painful either way. And I don't know, the split psychologically, I think it puts less speculators into it takes out some speculation, and just makes it more psychologically acceptable to a lot of folks that aren't, you know, a lot of retail traders that don't really understand market caps and they just look at stock prices. But yeah, I mean, this is the first week or two of the split trading here, of the stock trading at the split. What are your thoughts about this? This is like kind of a historic split, obviously, and now we're at $276 instead of, you know, $825 or something like that. So I mean, I think 825 would be a lot harder to swallow than 276 for some reason psychologically. You know, do you think that's the case for a lot of people?
It is strange how that, you know, kind of does seem to have an impact of like, I'm still, it's been a week now, I'm still like struggling to be like, what was it pre-split? And I'm like, no, I just need to get used to this. We've spoken about the split before, and it really shouldn't have any impact on, you know, in the long term. So I don't know, there's potentially some risk that run up leading into the split and then coming off the split. I really think that was too much of an issue, to be honest with you, because if you look at the last couple of weeks, Tesla really has outperformed the market if you consider its beta. To me, it seems like Tesla's been a relatively strong performer in an overall very weak market. I try not to get, you know, too worked up about the split. But I think the more we fall, I mean, the more I'm just like focusing more and more on fundamentals and, you know, like revising my Q3 numbers and Q4 numbers and then like taking a finer, you know, pencil to my 2023 expectations and like running some sensitivity analyses. And I think there's really great opportunity from here just on the fundamentals, but it remains to be seen, you know, how long this you know, kind of short-term pain is going to last. And then I would say on top of that, like we didn't get some of the catalysts that we were hoping for. Like one was the you know, investment grade credit rating. Most people were expecting that to happen in August. We have one more day left, and so it's seemingly unlikely that that'll happen you know, in the shorter term. So I don't know. It's just the macro has potential to beat up for maybe another month or two until Tesla reports earnings. I don't know. What are you thinking about the split now?
Yeah, the split. It's going to be a while before we get to, you know, a four digit stock price. It will happen, I think, but it's going to take a lot longer than the last split, you know. But I'm happy with the split. Get it out of the way. They'll have to do another split at some point in a few years, I think, and people will talk about it again. But at least I think we all witnessed kind of what a normal, a nothing burger of a split. I saw boiled down in the comments and it was a nothing burger, biggest nothing burger split of all time. And I think that's what splits should be. They should really be a nothing burger, you know? So I'm glad in a way that like there wasn't some kind of mega drop right after this. I was worried that like people were buying into the split thinking it's going to like go through the roof like the last time. And then the stock, everyone would sell at the same time afterwards and it would go down 20% or 10 or 20% in a day.
Yeah.
I was a little bit worried about that possibility. So it doesn't seem like that happened. I was pretty sure it wasn't going to go up like crazy like it did, you know, the last split, because that last split, the timing of that and the S&P inclusion speculation and just the market overall, the macro market overall going up was just, it was all a combination of things and such. So, but I know I also saw in the chat, someone was talking about how Bradford Ferguson is breaking, you know, the energy credits, the more complicated energy credits Tesla is receiving. And he's been doing the rounds, kind of trying to explain that on Warren Redlick's channel. And I think on the Jordan's Limiting Factor channel, and now he's doing he's doing a good job getting the word out about that. Those are some nice, you know, extra, you know, meaty or energy credits on steroids, I guess, that Tesla is going to be getting, it seems like, for their battery production and energy. You know, it seems like it's going to be a bigger impact, right? More billions of dollars to Tesla's bottom line. But at the same time, I feel like it's less important to Tesla than it was in the past, because even though it's like, maybe it's the credit is like double the amount per car, or I don't know, whatever it is, I feel like overall Tesla's business is so much bigger that instead of being, and Tesla doesn't need it to survive like it did in the past, perhaps, that it's less consequential to Tesla's valuation or future valuation overall. It's a nice extra, like, you know, cherry on top for Tesla, obviously, right? Nice extra margins. But my feeling is that it's not as big of a deal as maybe it would have been, you know, 3 or 4 years ago if they were getting this extra credit. What do you think, Matt?
Yeah, I think that's a fair assessment. And maybe just to take a step back for those who haven't seen, you know, what Bradford was talking about, there's kind of buried in this Inflation Reduction Act, you know, legislation that was passed recently. There was, I think it was $35 per kilowatt hour for battery cells made in the U.S. and $10 for battery packs, so like assembling them into modules. That was something that I think most people were not expecting. And it equate, like if you think about where Tesla's pricing is right now, and those, it's unclear, but it seems like it's somewhere around like $100 per kilowatt hour, and they've spoken about like trying to get that down by half, which would be, you know, roughly $50 per kilowatt hour, and then you're talking about a $35 per kilowatt hour subsidy. So it's incredibly impactful. There is a little bit of uncertainty. Rob Maurer highlighted this around whether Tesla actually does qualify for these, because there's this language that you have to sell it to a third party. So, you know, my contention is that if Tesla puts the batteries into a car and then sells that car to a third party, I don't see how that, you know, would disqualify them from, you know, receiving the benefit. But I think it's at least appropriate to point out that there's a bit of uncertainty around whether or not Tesla will qualify for the full, you know, $35 per kilowatt hour. But if they do, to your point, it's like, you know, $1 billion per year. Or no, I think it's like $3 billion once Austin's at like full capacity potentially. So it could be like $1 an EPS per year. And this is post split, which is really impactful. I think it's certainly very helpful, but to your point, Emmett, like Tesla clearly didn't really need this. But it did get me thinking about the conversation we had, you know, with Josh and Jordan out around the battery roundtable that we had, and just how kind of heavy of a lift it's going to be to get battery manufacturing and frankly even just like mining available in the United States at this kind of scale that we need. So while Tesla probably doesn't need the benefit, I do think it's a reasonable policy, all things considered, to try to jumpstart this industry instead of just kind of letting China lead the way on all this. So that may be a controversial take. I know a lot of people support, you know, free markets overall, but I kind of think of all the, you know, handouts and policies out there, this one's maybe not as terrible as some of the others.
Yeah, I agree. And what's interesting also, I noticed that Jordan from The Limiting Factor, people know him by his YouTube channel. If you don't watch it, it's very technical and goes over great details of like the batteries and chemistries and mining and all that. It's really, really informing on details. But he mentioned that, you know, he could tell from the YouTube comments, someone even said that they're one of the policy makers for this bill. And so it's good that the YouTube efforts that not, you know, that all the Tesla audio, you know, Tesla influencers combined are making, that somehow it's getting through to the policymakers of, you know, these political bills that are being, you know, these people are getting informed by, you know, Jordan of The Limiting Factor to help structure their policy bill in a more efficient, because I think it's surprising how much thought appears to have gone into this energy credit stuff. And I was curious, like, how did they get this deep? I guess they've been very looking closely at all the stuff. So it's really encouraging to see that, you know, the YouTube channels do make a difference in some cases. So I just wanted to throw that in there.
That was really awesome to hear, because, you know, from our view, like, we're in a bit of a bubble here, right? But I think you and I would both agree that there's just a tremendous amount of like brain power in this community, and like really thoughtful analysis that people put out. And so for this to be, you know, like kind of leaving the bubble and actually impacting policy is a huge turning point, I think. So I think it goes to the power that this kind of community has to be able to put out content like that, that's starting to shape policy. And clearly, I think we've had an impact on like institutional investors as well, just with some of the like research theses that kind of showed up in the retail community first and kind of slowly made their way to institutions. So it's great to see, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. And the other really big news that we have to get to with Tesla is the 10.69 release. I don't think I didn't get it, but I know we were talking about maybe yesterday you'd get the 10.69.1 release, but I don't think you got it either. And so the newest will be more of the wide scale beta release in another week, I guess, or something. But there's now apparently 10,000 instead of 1,000, there's now apparently 10,000 people it was pushed out to. And we'll be part of that next group where it goes to all the wide release, I guess. But it looks, from the videos I'm watching, it looks really impressive. It looks really encouraging. I mean, that Chuck Cook left turn. Were you and I the first people to interview Chuck Cook, by the way? I think we might have been.
I think we were. I mean, that was like a year ago. I think we had Chuck
yeah,
on.
Yeah, it was
like
a year ago. Yeah.
It's so funny. He's like this like superstar in the community now. And like he's been putting out like solid content for such a long time. But
he's been great. His videos are really thought well done, and like he has these, the key is he's got that drone that looks at it from the bird's eye view live while he's doing it from the car. So you can see both angles. That's what differentiates him and how he can get across what's going on. And so I really commend Chuck Cook. He's done a tremendous job getting awareness out on this thing. And I love how he keeps tweeting out like, we saw the Tesla full self-drive beta testers coming at 9 a.m. today, or they started at 9:45 a.m. today. And he's like very, because you know Elon's following him, and Elon's top Tesla people are following Chuck Cook. And so Chuck Cook inadvertently, I don't think he's doing it on purpose, but he's actually helping to keep a check on the people below them that are supposed to be testing this out, making sure they're not starting too late in the day and just, you know, doing a 20% effort when they should be doing 100% effort. You know, I'm not saying they would, but the fact that Chuck Cook is tweeting all this and being so transparent about it, I think helps make the people doing the testing much more accountable. I'm pretty sure most people at Tesla are very accountable, but you know, there's always a few bad apples that are just lazy and just trying to get through the day of their job. They don't really like their job, they're just doing it. And Tesla has some of those people, you just don't know, but it has a much less proportion of those people you'd think than most companies, but every company has those people. But Chuck Cook, by tweeting this out, I feel like helps keep those people, make sure they're in check. So they're like, I better do what I'm supposed to be doing because Chuck Cook's out there watching and tweeting about it. So I think it's really cool just Chuck being so active in the community, getting the word out about this thing, and then helping to be transparent as he's watching them test it and fix it real time, and then getting the word out about how it's been fixed. It's really incredible.
The other thing I think is really amazing about his videos is that like he has the dashboard right there, which shows whether the brake pedal is applied, whether the accelerator was pressed, you know, velocity, whether autopilot is engaged or not. And so like a lot of times I've seen videos that like make FSD look amazing. And then it's like, you kind of find out later that like they were hitting the accelerator and like, well, that's not an intervention, I'm just trying to make it go faster. So, you know, like a little skeezy that way, and like trying to make it look better or the other way, make it look worse, like, you know, Dan O'Dowd style. So I think the fact that he just is like, he's got all the stats there and he's like very kind of like straight and narrow, and he's critical where he thinks it's due. I mean, he doesn't think that they're going to be able to really solve like robo-taxis without a major hardware change, which I think is a reasonable thesis. I'm not sure that I believe it or not. I keep going back and forth on that, but like he's like very reasonable in his assessments. And I think he just has a huge amount of credibility for that reason. I mean, you can't really accuse him of any sort of manipulation. He's just like literally spitting out all the data in real time right there.
Yeah, really impressive. Yeah, I'm really impressed by Chuck especially. And then all the beta testers are doing great. I mean, Omar does great showing all his videos. And I know Dirty Tesla, isn't that who you went out with one time? He does a great job. Yeah, and Rob Mauer's done a few good videos, you know, and I don't know what happened to Galley. I haven't seen him put any videos out recently about his test self-driving, but he's done some in the past. So it's exciting to see where this is going. I mean, it's changing fast, right? This is history, you know, and Elon still reaffirmed yesterday that he thinks, I guess at the Norway symposium or whatever he was invited, reaffirmed that he hopes to get it to wide release, you know, globally or at least wide release in the US by the end of the year, perhaps in Europe too or something, depending on regulations. So Elon is sticking to his guns of his timeline. I mean, end of the year is like 3 months now. It's not like in the past when he said by the end of the year, it was like 9 or 10 or 11 months away. Like, Elon time. But now it's like 3 months away and it's like end of year, you know, like that's
four technically, but yeah.
Four months. But it feels like three because then Christmas, you know, December is like a big holiday month, whatever. So, but yeah, it's coming up fast. And, you know, kudos to that Tesla self-driving, you know, FSD team and everything. And they're really working hard. You could tell, and they have meetings on Saturdays and Sundays, like at any time it sounds like. And, Elon at the, you know, he's looking really healthy, right? Elon, he's doing like, he tweeted about, he's doing this intermittent fasting. And I thought, I was like, I was so excited when I heard that. And the fact that he lost 20 pounds is so amazing. Like, man, Elon's finally getting his health in order, it feels like. And I'm like, whatever that friend is that's giving you that suggestion that you're following, stick with that friend because that's like the best possible thing. I mean, Elon has said his philosophy in the past is like, take the best course of action, set of actions that improves the possibility for a good future of humanity. That's like his philosophy in a nutshell. Well, part of that should be improving his health because he should recognize that he himself is very important for a good future success of humanity. And for he himself to survive long enough to be most impactful, he has to have good health and he should be working on his health, you know? And so I'm really happy to see Elon getting healthy. He seemed to have better energy. And I think the fasting stuff is, there's nothing better than that to try to help cleanse yourself. That's personally, but Elon seems to be benefiting from it, which is great.
Yeah, a lot of people might not know that you're like very much into health and, you know, healthy living and, you know, fasting and sauna and all sorts of stuff like that. And it's like I'm not as into that as you, but like I've made some pretty meaningful changes recently too. And it's like amazing what just like a little thoughtfulness on that personal health side, how much of an impact that can have on your energy level and just like clarity of your thought and that sort of thing. And that's been a concern of mine around Elon's for a while because he had this quote a couple of years ago about like, you know, like I forget exactly what it was, but somebody asked him like, I don't remember the specifics of it enough, but it was something to the effect of like, we should enjoy eating a fine cheese and not like worry about trying to live to 100 or something like that. And
like, yeah. Something like that. Like just enjoy the bread and butter.
Yeah. Something like that. Yeah. And I was like, I agree with that. And like, I, you know, from time to time, of course, like everything in moderation, including moderation. Right. Like, I think that's like a great way to kind of live. But you know, it's like, it's good to see that he's seeing the other part of it and, you know, trying to do fasting and take care of himself a little bit more. Cause that was like the key man risk seemed to be increasing the last, you know, year or two with pick and fight with Russia and then not eating so healthy and just, you know, working ungodly hours and like, he's getting up there now. Like
and his sleep has always been off. His sleep is always talking about how he doesn't sleep. And then you see pictures of him in the sun and he's like a ghost and you're like, man, what does he need to get some sun? You know? And he did reference he did reference and like a few Twitter posts by Andrew Huberman. I'm not sure if you know who that is, but Huberman Lab, like this guy's, I listened to his podcast. He's one of these doctors and he's in a circle of doctors, him and like Dr. Peter Attia and a bunch of others that are in the same kind of circle. I really follow them closely and I think they have a good beat on health in general and how to optimize health. And so I hope Elon is in that circle of health to some degree to get the low hanging fruit, you know, optimizing sleep and getting some sunlight and, you know, intermittent fasting at least or whatever, you know, there's lots of things he can do. Cutting out, you know, added sugar, obviously, and maybe seed oils, that kind of stuff. So there's lots of things I think he's probably doing low hanging fruit to improve his health quickly. And it's looking good. I'm very happy about that. So that's been something a lot of people have been worried about for a long time. Like, Elon, please get healthy. You see that with a lot of, no one wants to be rude and be like, Elon, you look unhealthy. You look, you're getting fat, you know, whatever. No one wants to say that, but you know, everyone gets like that as they get older anyway. You just have to do your best as you get older. You got to combat it. And that's, you know, you're 35, Matt, is that what you're 36 or something like that? Yeah. So when I was like 35, 36, that's close to my breaking point where I was like, I had to rediscover my health and like change things a lot, maybe at 38 or something like that. But there comes a point in every person's life where they're like, oh, I'm, you know, my health is going down fast. I got to do something different, you know? And I guess Elon's maybe hit that point or whatnot.
Yeah. So yeah, like I've had to start, you know, exercising and watching my diet a lot more than I used to. I mean, I've had a pretty fast metabolism most of my life, but just like it's unavoidable that just slows down as you get older. So it's tough to, you know, keep on track of that as you get older.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. So, okay. So the other big news, there's a lot of actually big items that happened the last week. A lot of it happened like days ago. And this happened, I think, around the time or the day after you did your last live stream with Yashu, was the whistleblower report for Twitter, right? I mean, I don't think you guys touched on that too much last week, but more details came out. And then you have this new letter filed by Elon. Apparently, I just saw it was talked about today. I guess there was like a form filed publicly about the new letter Elon's lawyers filed like yesterday to, you know, reconfirm that they want to exit the Twitter deal.
Yeah.
And because of the whistleblower, you know, revelations here. So the whistleblower, what are your thoughts on that? I mean, my thought is, just to go into it real quick, is Elon has said, I mean, we all know that Elon is friends with Jack Dorsey, right? He's personal friends with Jack Dorsey, right? And I don't know how often they talk, but he said he's good friends with Jack a couple times, I feel like. And so good friends to me means like, oh, you talk sort of regularly. That's what I sort of think of, right? Not like once a year you touch base or something. It's like, hey, every few weeks we talk about whatever. We're in the same circle and we chat. So my thought was like, Jack Dorsey hired this whistleblower, you know, a year and a half ago or something like that, and 2 years ago or something. And then for the purpose, because Jack Dorsey probably thought the Twitter security stuff was out of hand after that hack by the teenagers and so all that.
Yeah.
And Elon must have known about some of this because they're good friends. And maybe Elon, and so Jack Dorsey told him what's going on. And you see Elon sitting by the wayside wondering like, oh, Twitter, we're going to lose Twitter. Twitter's going to self-destruct. Maybe I should take it over or something, knowing that this is bad. And maybe he didn't know all the details. But I feel like through hearsay or some comment, like he must have known going into his offer that there was lots of issues with Twitter behind the scenes with security, I would think. So my thought on that is that Elon is trying to use everything he can to get a better price, that he still is interested in buying Twitter despite this last letter that just came out yesterday, even that he's trying to just get the better. He's trying to put the pressure and turn the screws on Parag and the board to like settle for a lower price instead of 44 billion, maybe like 35 billion or something like that. I don't know. What's your interpretation of all this matter? What do you think? Anything new?
Yeah. I mean, I agree with what you just said. Like, I think, you know, listening to the All In podcast guys, I mean, they had kind of differing takes. You know, one was that like I think Chamath was saying that, but this whistleblower actually wasn't super supportive of the case that Elon was making, because he did say that, you know, the bots weren't necessarily the issue. But then, you know, Sachs was saying that there's actually, you know, another document where he did say that there was kind of a significant issue with the fact that they were calculating MDAO insufficiently. So, you know, I'm not too clear whether this helps or hurts Elon from a you know, legal standpoint, to be honest with you. But I think the fact that he did file this kind of second letter terminating the merger agreement on different grounds, it's like he's adding in another layer to the fight. So like he only needs to win on one of these now, essentially, to let the deal fall apart. So I don't know. I think I had been thinking, you know, maybe a month ago that there was like a 75% chance that the deal goes through just at some modestly lower price. But I don't know. In reading through everything recently, I think the issues at Twitter are probably more significant than, you know, anyone really realized. And so I could see Elon just saying like, listen, I don't have time for that. I want to do Starship and I want to figure out FSD. And like, yes, it would be great to, you know, preserve free speech, but this is just like going to require way more of an overhaul than I initially, you know, was planning on. So I'm kind of getting the sense that he's just ready to kind of walk and be done. So I don't know. I have low confidence in that prediction, but I think, you know, if it were up to Elon, I'd say he walks away. And I don't know, if I had to peg it on a percent, I say maybe there's only a 40% chance the deal actually gets done at some lower price now. 60% wow. that, you know, walks away, that it breaks up. But that's admittedly an uneducated guess, because he needs the
legal system to kind of,
you know, work through this.
Yeah. So. Yeah. I think he would walk away if the judge lets him out right now. I think he would, and he's willing to walk away at this price, but I think Twitter stock would drop dramatically, like fast, especially in this market environment. And they'd beg before that happens. I think they'd beg him to, like, if they got wind or somehow the judge was like, listen, there might be some like quiet period where it's not public, but the judge is communicating to Elon and Twitter, like, hey, I'm going to have to scrub this deal unless you work. I don't know how the actual communications works, but if they talk to the Twitter board reconvenes, like, all right, Elon, can we do it at 35 billion? That's the last. Otherwise, and then Elon would be like, okay, that's kind of, I think, the way it would go. Then I'm not sure every step of the way is public from this point forward with the, I mean, it probably is. It all becomes public at some point, but I'm not sure it's like real time public. I'm not informed enough on these lawsuits to know for sure, but maybe there's other communications behind the scenes going on between Elon's camp and Twitter's legal camp to negotiate potentially before that even happens. So I think it happens at a lower valuation, but I think he's ready to walk away possibly if he's given that opportunity and Twitter doesn't want to. I can't see Twitter not wanting to settle at a lower price, given that their stock is going to be more than cut in half if it falls through.
Yeah, I was just going to ask, like, how low do you think it would go if Elon was allowed to walk? Like, presume he pays the $1 billion breakup fee or whatever, but he just walks.
Yeah.
I mean, geez. I mean, look,
it's $39 right now, $30 billion valuation. I mean, that's still higher than, well, look at Snapchat. Snapchat went from, in the same amount of time since the deal happened. So March, Snapchat was like $40. So Snapchat was 10 billion. So Snapchat is cut down by 75%. Since the deal was announced. Twitter, by contrast, has only been cut down. Let's see. Let me pull up the Twitter chart for the last like 9 months or whatever, since like January, March or whatever. I think Twitter is close to where it was when that happened, because Elon,
because he offered a premium, right?
And like he bought shares.
40 to keep or 45 it booed. And he offered 54.
It's actually higher. Yeah, Twitter was, Twitter was back then around $35. Yeah. So
that's crazy. Wow.
So Twitter could get cut down to $10 a share, I would say potentially maybe less, like I don't see people buying Twitter, they don't see a profitability path for it. Just like Robinhood. You don't see a profitability path for Robinhood, that thing's getting cut down, all the time from where it was. And I think you have a similar story with Twitter, $10 or below, I think, with Twitter. What do you think, man?
Yeah. I mean, I think there's a couple different layers to this. I mean, one would be like it's been completely insulated from macro recently, just because this buyout has been like a buoy. So if you take that out, then it probably would have been cut roughly in half, I think, just because Twitter's, like you said, Twitter's more, dependent on advertising. So I think it would follow something close to, Snap or Meta or something like that, where, it's just dependent on advertising dollars. But then on top of that, with all this discovery and whistleblower lawsuit, it's like there's actually way more risk. Serious issues and risk.
So much risk. Yeah.
Than was previously recognized. So maybe you take another 30-40% haircut from there. So yeah, like I can certainly see where you get down to like the low teens or something like that as a price, or maybe even 10. I mean, if this were just allowed to like free fall, and then like who's got confidence in Parag at this point? Or the board in general. I mean, it's just the whole thing has been so mismanaged. And there's really, frankly, no business plan, like you said, and presumably advertising revenues are going to be plummeting. So, I don't know. It's a tough situation. And if I were in Elon's shoes, I mean, I would want to be walking away.
I mean, Twitter's going to drop. I did too. I think Twitter drops to a 5 to 10 billion valuation in that range. Right now it's 30 billion. At the current stock price of $40. So 5 to 10 billion valuation is what my guess is after after he pulls out and he sells his shares, you know, like, and then if it drops to 5 to 10 billion, someone else could come along and buy it for 15 billion, you know, like for less than half the price, a third of the price of what he's trying, what he's being like. So yeah, it makes total sense for him to try to walk away at this price. Yeah. So
it's, this is healthy though. Like, cause when the, when the stock is like high and things are going well, like people don't really take the problems that seriously. I mean, kind of look at what happened with Peloton over the, you know, with the previous CEO who's like, oh, like our target market is to like sell 1 billion Pelotons and have like this like recurring revenue source that's like a sixth of the world's population, which was never a realistic proposition whatsoever. Because the stock was so high, like people didn't worry about like their cash flow generation or anything like that. Now that they've been like smacked, I don't know what it is, 80, 90%, they've got like a real like hard restructuring plan that's painful and, you know, that, but that actually has a chance of turning the company around. Like, I don't have any position in Peloton, but I think it's like that sort of market signal is important to, you know, to kind of show to management that like you've got to actually seriously turn the ship around, because if you try to do a capital raise when you're valued at, you know, 5 billion, like that's going to be a very painful thing for dilution, and like you're not going to be able to raise very much money. So
I see Larry. I see Larry Goldberg. Larry, how you doing? He says maybe Elon pays the 1 billion breakup, then buys it at the market after it falls to $10 per share. That'd be great, because I think, what is it, Einhorn or someone has bought, like gave it 90% or 80% chances of passing and bought a bunch of Twitter at like $39 or $40 or something. Didn't some famous Tesla bear buy a whole bunch of Twitter, assuming it's going to go up to $50 or whatever?
And I don't know. That I didn't see that.
Yeah, I think it was Einhorn. If someone on the comments, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it was Einhorn. So yeah, it would be great to see another Tesla bear bite the dust on something else other than Tesla like that. That's Elon related. Anyway, so the last thing is, I guess the Artemis launch was scrubbed. The ULA, you know, biggest rocket of all time or something was about to get launched yesterday or the day before.
Biggest boondoggle of all time.
Biggest boondoggle, yeah. I mean, we touched a little bit about it yesterday. I mean, I think that part of my conspiracy, semi-conspiracy theory thought is that part of the reason Starship is getting delayed approval to do its test flight to orbit is because you know, the folks who are in charge of approving it, you know, are behind the scenes holding it back or delaying it because they want to see the ULA get the notoriety or the publishing, you know, get some fame with the public for being like the biggest launch rocket since the Saturn V or whatever. And so someone else, so they, you know, all the billions of dollars they've sent to, you know, get burned with the ULA to build this thing for way longer than it needed, should have taken, that gets some sort of fame and credit before SpaceX steals the show entirely with the Starship going forward. What do you think? What were your thoughts, Matt?
Yeah, I mean, it's just like this program probably should have been canceled years ago. I mean, it's just so over budget. I think the latest figure I saw was that they've spent $12 billion on it so far, and they clearly haven't even, you know, sent a single, you know, ship up yet. They were trying to launch and there was an engine malfunction. So it's like you spent $12 billion and you don't know if this thing works. And like, because it's like a cost plus contract, like you can't like recover that. And on top of that, this is like a fully expendable rocket. So it's just like very clearly not the future. You know, like everyday astronaut Tim Dodd, he's like a like roots for everyone kind of guy. But even he was saying like a year or two ago that like it's cool to like watch this thing get developed, but it's pretty irresponsible to actually, you know, like be paying for this, especially when there's like private companies who are willing to bear the financial risk of something like this going forward. But I think NASA was just so far down the road, and there's this sunk cost fallacy that I think is kind of playing into this that. They want to get at least one launch out of this massive program that's been, I don't even know how long
in
development.
But. Yeah, because if they don't get any launch out, if the Starship goes off and is a great success and over, then this ULA thing is like, dust. Like, why would they even launch it at all? And all that money's wasted, and so many people are bigger trouble than they already are for it, right? So to me, it makes sense that they want to get this off before they let Starship go to orbit. I don't know. That's what I thought.
Yeah, I kind of think they'll be, give it like maybe 3 or 4 launches that they'll do, like pay another $2 billion to get a couple more launches out of it. And then they'll be like, well, you know, we did a cost benefit analysis and we realized that Starship's actually just a much better option for deep space missions or for heavy payload orbits or heavy payloads to the moon. But, well, yeah, that was obvious 5 years ago, but well, whatever. It's just frustrating that this is happening.
Yeah. So, all right. Well, that's 2 goals Elon has said, I think, for this year is the full self-driving beta, FSD beta, wide release to the general public in the U.S. at least, and getting Starship to orbit. Those are 2 exciting goals for the next few months. It would be super cool if both of those goals are met. So I guess we'll go on to the Q&A, right? We've talked a lot. Let's try to go 20 minutes or something for Q&A, a little longer than usual since we've talked longer. All right. From Tesla to Derium on Twitter, how much revenue does a virtual power plant generate as a grid service versus revenue from the energy arbitrage? Matt, I'll let you.
Let me nerd out on that.
Yes.
I would say there's probably more potential for revenue generation from grid services. So things like capacity or, I just lost an earbud. That was, sorry about that.
That's okay. I hear you fine.
It's hard to quantify and it's going to vary market to market. But when I was, doing this work back when I was working in energy, people think that like buying energy low and selling high is like a way to make a ton of money. But I think it actually ends up being the case that you get maybe 50% of the revenue potential out of doing that. And you can get like another 50%, the other 50% from selling ancillary services. But like exactly how you stack those services, it varies market to market. So it really is hard to quantify. What I will say is when I took a kind of deep dive in this about a year and a half ago, the rough math that I was coming up with was that like for a Tesla home that had like EV charging, 2 power walls and a solar roof. I thought the revenue potential from a VPP overall was about $400 per year and that you'd split that some amount between Tesla and from the asset owner. So I think that's broadly the size of the opportunity. But right now what we've seen is that Tesla's actually giving the majority of that benefit to the owners and not really taking a slice. So hopefully that changes over time.
Good answer. All right, next question from Andrew Bazile. How you doing, Andrew? Question, what do you think are the key rate limiting factors for Tesla Energy right now? How soon do you think we might see serious acceleration in Tesla Energy's growth? I'll take a quick one quick thing and I'll let you give a much more detailed answer. My initial thought is the batteries they're trying to maximize with the vehicles. But when they have excess battery supply that they can divert away from vehicles, when vehicle demand met, or maybe there's other issues limiting the supply of vehicles they can provide, then they will divert excess batteries to energy storage or Tesla Energy stuff. But my other thought is, in the past, I remember, 5 or 6 years ago, Tesla was like a, sub $100 billion market cap company. You'd look at, Tesla Energy being this magnanimous opportunity. And I think it's hard for me to get out of that mindset, like, magnanimous opportunity for a $50 billion market cap company to get a Tesla Energy to be 500, a few $100 billion was huge. But now I feel like at $1 trillion market cap or close to $1 trillion market cap, Tesla Energy, it could still be big, but it's not going to be, it's going to take a while to ramp. But, even to be the if it's $100 or $200 billion of revenue to Tesla a year, that's not going to move the needle a whole lot on Tesla's valuation like it would have, back when it was a $50 billion market cap. So I'm just trying to keep my perspective sometimes doesn't correct itself as the market cap of Tesla has gone up 10x from where it was, you know, same with like insurance, for example. Insurance, yeah, maybe it's going to add $100 billion market cap to the Tesla, you know, to Tesla's valuation. That's great, but it's already $1 trillion market cap. You know, that's not going to, you know, it's really the Tesla bot and all that stuff that moves the needle on multiplying the Tesla valuation from here, in my mind. Tesla bot and FSD, and just the overall growth and margins of the vehicles going up to like 20 million cars a year eventually. But Matt, sorry to go off tangent on that.
No, I completely agree with everything you said. Like, it really is rounding error at this point. And when you look forward to the next 10 years and like what the opportunities are, like Tesla Energy, I think is going to continue to kind of slowly compound. And, you know, like if we were to just have the 2030 Tesla Energies and like slot them in right now, we'd be like, oh my gosh, this is amazing. Like they've done,
yeah,
I don't know, $1 billion of margin per year or something like that. Like that would actually be, yeah, incredibly impactful right now. But like $1 billion of margin by 2030 is really not going to move the needle a whole lot. So, you know, it's a small thing. I think it'll continue to, you know, continue to grow, and it may show up as like a form of operating leverage. So you had Tesla Energy being like negative gross margin or very, very like flat to like zero gross margin. And so maybe if it's going forward, like I think it was 39 million or something like that of gross margin last quarter. So if they get that up to like $100 million per quarter or something like that, it's just like a little bit of extra compounding on the operating leverage where you're not dragging your overall gross margin down on that side of the business. So, you know, I think it'll be small, but I think it's going to be the sort of thing that really is going to be more meaningful on like the brand side. And so like 5 years down the road, if you're actually getting like revenue from your virtual power plant, and it's like a better user experience because you've got backup power for when the grid goes out, and like you can still charge your car and still like run your house during grid emergencies and things like that, or power outages. That's just such a better user experience that I get more excited about the customer facing side of this and how it will like actually positively, yeah, impact people's lives than I really
society
do about like the business,
yeah,
you know,
the valuation impact to the stock. Yeah. Yeah. The way I look at the stock valuation at $1 trillion now, like, It's not, you know, I love all the conglomerates of businesses under Tesla, but the three things most important in my mind and priority is Tesla bot being number one. That's going to move the needle the most in terms of multiplying the valuation. How successful can that be in the future? You know, what's the vision Elon's going to give us further on that? And this AI Day Part 2 coming up is amazing for that, for more information. And then the second thing is FSD. You know, and that's a lot closer to fruition, you know, mass wide scale FSD globally to enable robo taxis and self-driving, just the most advanced level 4 driving capabilities. I think that's very, it's much closer than people think potentially. But people have a hard time imagining how that's going to change the economics of Tesla. And the third thing that's also moves the needle, that's less important than those two in my mind, but it's more nut and bolts. People can understand it better because they see it happening before their eyes with the gross margins, is the actual production of the hardware, the cars, and producing the cars and selling them, like their manufacturing capability of the cars, how the gross margins are improving so much, their pricing power with the supply and demand imbalance, and the product just being superior to everything else out there still from a hardware perspective, you know? And so the ramp up with more factories and stuff, that's the third of those three things in my mind. And then beyond those three things can move the market cap in multiples potentially. But beyond those three things, everything else is sort of like side, you know, side orders, you know, insurance, Tesla Solar even, or Solar Roof, or, you know, they're all great businesses in and of themselves. They could be multi-hundred million dollar market cap companies by themselves, but a multi-100 billion market cap to Tesla is like nothing for what it's going to be in the future, you know? So, for all those other three things I just listed, I think in my mind. So, you know, that's how I think of it, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I would agree with that. Although, I mean, the credit for the cells that they're manufacturing will certainly have a positive impact on the energy side of the business. So that may show up on that side as well.
That's a good point. All right, next question here. From Melody of 1974. Question, what is your thoughts with Starlink and T-Mobile working together? Oh, yeah, that's great. That's another announcement we didn't news, sort of Elon-related, Tesla, SpaceX-related, we forgot to cover. So a lot of news this past week. Yeah. I think it's great. I think it's a step in the direction of globally connected human population that SpaceX is ready to take sole responsibility for if necessary. And I think, yeah, it's an incredible step in the right direction for the future of humanity in general. You know, cell phones connecting directly to the satellites in the sky, you know, your Tesla car directing connectly to the satellite. I mean, this technology, I kind of suspected this was going to happen at some point. I didn't know how it was going to happen. I thought we'd be years away, but it sounds like it's right around the corner now. It's crazy. Like, you know, this is really incredible. Like I've thought that this was going to happen at some point, but everyone's like, oh, it's impossible. Physics don't allow it or whatever. And I'm like, I don't know. Think physics, people invent things, new things. We see things. It sounds like SpaceX has developed a certain type of satellite with some specialized antenna or ways to bounce signals to cell phones hundreds of kilometers away. I mean, it's pretty impressive, Matt. What are your thoughts?
I couldn't believe that they've designed this to work with your existing phone. So like your phone is next to a tower that I don't know. Yeah. What's the average cell tower? Like half a mile away from you or something like that? And they're like, you can just use your same phone and go up like 60 miles into space or however high it is.
Yeah.
And we've designed it to work that way. Like that is a colossal engineering challenge that they somehow figured out. I was thinking similar to you, Emmett, that something like this would happen eventually, but I kind of thought that they'd like need to have somebody like T-Mobile like design and manufacture and install like specialty cell towers that could like both connect to space and connect to your phone and like be like that intermediary. But they just like blew away that whole like second step. And so if you think of the capital efficiency of solving this problem to just work within that existing band of spectrum that they spoke about, I mean, it's remarkable. I was really blown away by that. I think it's going to be a huge revenue opportunity. Made me want to switch to T-Mobile, which I never had really considered before.
I'm thinking about it already.
I think it could be really good news, probably better news for T-Mobile than for it's definitely really good news for Starlink too, actually. So I don't know. I'm wishing I was invested in it now.
T-Mobile holding up pretty well in today's volatility, only down 0.5%, but it's got a market cap already of 180 billion. I don't know. We have to look at that one. It's, you know, I'm curious. Have to look at that. Anyway, it's really a good, incredible. Let's move on to the next question. From Roman G, question: January 2025 Tesla Leap options will be available in a couple of weeks. Will you be looking at those? Of course, we will be looking at them. January 2025. That's, you know, that's 2 years and a few months away. Yeah, I mean, that's an incredible time value for Tesla. A lot of time for things to change much more dramatically than we can anticipate at this point. You know, so I will definitely look at them. I think what happens with the Tesla Leap options when they first come out, they tend to have extra wide spreads, you know, so you have to be very careful because you're going to pay up for buying a January 2025 Tesla call option with the spread typically being, you know, the spread could be like 20% of the value of the option itself. It's kind of crazy. It could be more, I don't know, or less, but typically if you wait a few weeks, the spreads start tightening. And that's a better time. You get a better value for your buck, assuming Tesla doesn't like run up in those few weeks, obviously, but it could also go down in those few weeks and then you get even better value. Right. So, just be careful with Tesla Leap options when they first come out. You know, if you're going to pay the ask price, you're going to get ripped off. Or if you're going to sell some covered calls, for example, you're also going to get ripped off on selling to the bid because the spread, bid ask spread, is usually really wide initially. For a while, could be weeks or months even.
Yep.
Next question is from Brian. Good Soil Investment Management. Why don't you think Tesla isn't using their own panels on Giga Texas? Why are they using the supplier Q cells? I haven't heard of this. So they're not using their own solar panels at Giga Texas. I guess they're using someone else's cells. I didn't know that. That's news to me. Did you know about this, Matt?
No, I hadn't heard that either. But so I'll respond maybe broadly rather than specifically. It does seem that Tesla has really been kind of de-emphasizing like traditional rooftop solar lately. And I really suspect that other companies have an advantage in manufacturing on that right now. I think Tesla has really focused their efforts on getting solar roof figured out and kind of optimizing. I think they optimize the manufacturer and the production of that, but they really need to optimize the installation of that now. So I think that's the step that they're going to be working on in the meantime. I mean, there's lots of companies selling these kind of traditional rooftop solar installations. And I think Tesla is like, well, let's not compete in that like highly competitive. Just leapfrog to the next thing and kind of focus on the side of the market. I think I just lost my connection for a second.
No,
Can
we
you hear me?
hear you. Yeah, I hear you fine.
Okay.
Yep.
So that, and then also clearly on the stationary storage side, they're you know building out that 40 gigawatt hour plant annual capacity. So I think they're going to do a lot more on the stationary storage side. But I think it seems to me as an outside observer that they've de-emphasized traditional rooftop solar lately. So I think they're not you know spitting out any of those cells from those panels from the Buffalo plant anymore.
All right, let's do one more question. We're a little over an hour already, so we'll do one more. Kushal on YouTube comments. What are your thoughts on vehicle to load for Tesla service, Tesla vehicles, vehicle to load for Tesla vehicles? I would love to get a Powerwall, but where I am in Michigan, they don't offer it. Do you think Cybertruck will have the vehicle to load? What do you think, man? Do you think that they'll do that? That's the vehicle to like grid
Vehicle to
or vehicle
grid,
like.
it's usually called
Or vehicle to your
VTG.
house, even, I guess, something like
So
that.
just before I do it, a couple people have said in the comments, Larry and DRK that are one other person I think that Tesla actually doesn't do their own cell their own panels anymore. So it sounds like that's true. They're not making those traditional kind of like rooftop panels anymore. So that would explain it. And I think that makes sense for them. There's a lot of other companies, and you really need a massive plant to be kicking out a ton of those at very low cost. And I think that's just not in Tesla's interest right now. But getting back to the vehicle to grid, it's a nice to have, I think. And I think it would be good to have like an outlet because you've got the Ford F-150 Lightning has that charging. I think the Rivian has it too, where you can, you know, push power back out. So I think the Cybertruck will have that. I don't know if Elon already said that they will, but he was asking me those questions a year or two ago about what would be good to have. And, you know, I think like a pneumatic pump was one of the things they said, and you know, a 220 outlet. So I suspect they'll have all those things.
I think we lost you on your AirPods, Matt.
Oh,
Your AirPod, we lost you.
I'm falling apart
Let's see
again.
here. You're probably
Right, can
still
you hear
picked
me
up on the
now?
YouTube channel. That's where.
I think you can hear me now. My, I
Okay,
gotta
we
get out
lost your AirPod. Maybe put on
my tech
speakerphone
gear.
on your phone. If you put on speakerphone on your phone, then the Twitter Spaces can still hear you.
It says I'm connected to my AirPods, so I think you guys should be able to hear me on Twitter Spaces.
Yeah, I think.
But oh, my mic was turned off. Sorry about
Oh, now his mic's there. Okay.
Jeez, technical issues.
So.
I finally got like this echo, I think, under control, and now
Oh
my AirPods are dying. So sorry about that, everyone.
gosh. All right.
No, so
Yeah.
I do think Cybertruck will probably have vehicle to grid. I did do some analysis on this a while ago. The like I think the actual monetary opportunity of vehicle to grid is actually not that high. So I think people think it's like, oh, you can like sell all this extra power, and
Yeah.
that's technically true. But you lose a little bit due to you know like the round trip efficiency. And probably the bigger issue is just that customers have that there's a lot of like regulations on actually selling. Like typically residential customers can't sell at wholesale prices to really take advantage of the big swings. And so utilities have a lot of power in kind of shaping how customers could get paid. So I think eventually Teslas will have this like vehicle to grid you know capability, and it will be integrated with like the entire Tesla Energy kind of like home offering. But like it's a pretty small opportunity, and you can actually take advantage of it. Like if you were to bundle the house and have like interruptible charging, for example, there's ways to get paid for that within the existing grid infrastructure. That's probably easier than doing vehicle to grid. So I kind of suspect they're going to focus on that and try to monetize that opportunity rather than, you know, going down the both the technical and the regulatory challenge of doing like vehicle to grid charging.
Yeah. Cool. All right. Well, I think this has been a good episode, and I see a few people saying that the echo is still a little bit there. So we've tried, Matt, you have a professional like microphone. What's the brand of the microphone you have again? It's
People are always like, well, I don't know why Good Soil doesn't invest in a professional microphone. This is a professional microphone. It's like a Yeti.
What's the brand?
It's a Yeti. Yeah.
Okay. So if anyone in the comments, we appreciate feedback, obviously. But if anyone in the comments has an idea of like a better microphone or a better setup that we could try for Matt that you think would reduce the echo, we're all ears. So we're trying to figure things out. Open to suggestions. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, and that might minimize it, but then you can't see my face. Maybe that's a benefit.
Yeah, I see. Boiled down, saying the mic is fine just in a room with flat walls. But there's lots of people that do this stuff in a room with flat walls, and they somehow don't have an echo. You know, so there's something we can do. I think. Yeah. I just don't know exactly what. We're open to suggestions.
I'm getting a rug in here. It was shipped yesterday, I think. So. Should be getting.
One
a rug
guy said
that'll help.
One guy said Yeti is maybe too basic. Yeah, I have like a Heli microphone. It seems to work pretty well, or something. So. Closer to the mic. Yeah. So lots of interesting ideas. We'll look at the comments later and try something different. Hopefully fix that for the YouTube people. Because you sound fine on the Twitter spaces with the AirPods. But I'm pretty sure on YouTube spaces, there's probably an echo on YouTube live. Anyway, we'll see everyone next week. Thanks for the questions. And there'll probably be a lot of news to cover between now and next week again. So looking forward to chatting. All right. See you guys.